Yeah, thanks for letting me speak here. As as was mentioned, it's about a problem that was posed at one of the problem solving days at the Simons. So let me first explain the problem very briefly. So we are interested in spectrahedral cones. So let me recall what that is. So we take some real symmetric D by D matrices, A1 up to AN. And then we look at all points X in R to the N such that the corresponding linear combination of these matrices is positive semi-definite. So this is some nice convex semi-algebraic set in Rn. And it's interesting because it's the feasible set of a semi-definite program. And it's a generalization of polyhedral cones because we can, for example, take A of X to be, or all the AIs to be diagonal matrices, then this is just the solution set to finitely many linear inequalities. So now the question I'm interested in is which convex sets in R to the N are spectrahedral, so which can be described with such a linear matrix inequality. So there's one rather restrictive necessary criterion that I want to explain now. So let's look at our spectrahedral cone. Since it's convex, we can assume that it has non-empty interior. Otherwise, we can just pass to some strict linear subspace. And then we take some point in the interior of S. Then after maybe conjugating this matrix polynomial from the left and right with invertible matrices S and S transpose, we can assume that at this point this matrix polynomial is the identity matrix. Now let's look at the following polynomial. Let's take the determinant of this. So this is a polynomial in x1 to xn, and I claim that it has the following properties, which makes it hyperbolic in this sense. So it's a homogeneous polynomial, and it's hyperbolic with respect to E in the sense that it doesn't vanish at E. So this is clear because the determinant of the identity matrix is 1. And whenever we restrict this polynomial to any line in real line in direction of E, then the resulting univariate polynomial has only real zeros. And to polynomial having these properties, one can associate the hyperbolicity cone, just a set of all points where this univariate polynomial has only non-negative roots. So in our case, when H is this determinant, we just get the, when restricting to these lines, we just get the characteristic polynomial of a real symmetric matrix, which has, of course, only real eigenvalues. So this is fine, and the hyperbolicity cone is when this polynomial has only non-negative roots, so when A of V has only non-negative eigenvalues, so this is exactly the set we are interested in, the hyperbolicity cone. So this is a necessary criterion for a set to be a spectrahedral cone, namely that you can find it as the hyperbolicity cone of some hyperbolic polynomial. And then there's a major open question in this context which asks if this is also a sufficient criterion. So if you have any hyperbolicity cone, can you describe it using linear matrix inequalities? So it's true when you have only few variables or small degree, but in general, it's open. So let's see, how can we get hyperbolic polynomials? So one way we have already seen, we take this determinant of such a matrix. So this is already some interesting class of hyperbolic polynomials. It includes spanning tree polynomials of graphs or more general, the basis generating polynomials of regular matroids. And we have seen that these hyperplicity cones of these polynomials are clearly spectrahedral. So if we want to test this conjecture on some other hyperbolic polynomials, these are not the ones one should check it. So how to get other hyperbolic polynomials? So there's some operations preserving hyperbolicity. So what I want to explain now is by taking derivatives. So if you have a univariate polynomial, say of degree d, which has only real zeros, so d real zeros, then I claim that its derivative also has only real zeros. So this is in fact a direct consequence of Hollis theorem. So which says that between each two real zeros of p, there must be a real zero of p prime. So there must be d minus one real zeros of p prime, and this is the degree. So this is fine. And then we can translate this to this multivariate setting of hyperbolic polynomials. And we get that if a polynomial is hyperbolic with respect to E, then its directional derivative, which I denote like this, in direction of E, is also hyperbolic with respect to E. So now we can take these determinantal polynomials of which we know that they are hyperbolic and take a derivative and ask if the hyperbolicity cone of the resulting polynomial is still spectrahedral. And of course we can do this several times. We can take higher derivatives and still get the hyperbolic polynomial. We ask, is the hyperbolicity cone spectrahedral? So, and this is the question that was asked at the problem solving day, I think by Nikhil. And this is the content of the talk, is the answer to this question. So yeah. Okay, so let's look at this question. So first of all, we restrict to some special class of polynomials. So I claim that it suffices to show this claim for the generic D by D symmetric matrix. And by this, I mean a symmetric matrix where each entry is its own variable. So the entries of X are the variables X, I, J, where I is smaller or equal than J. And so this is sufficient to prove it for this, because if we want to prove it for general such linear matrix polynomials, we can just restrict this one to a suitable linear subspace, then we get this one. So we look at this for any size d and any k between 0 and d, we look at this kth derivative in direction of the identity matrix of the generic symmetric determinant. So let's try to express this polynomial in some other way. So we look at the characteristic polynomial of X. We can write it as a polynomial in T whose coefficients are polynomial or depend polynomially on the entries of X. And it's chosen in such a way that pk is homogeneous of degree k. So for example, p1 is then the trace of x and pd is the determinant of x. And now if we do like a Taylor series expansion of the left-hand side, we see that up to some scalar factor, these coefficients pk are exactly the polynomials we are interested in. Yeah, okay. But then there's also another way to look at these coefficients, right? So if you have a univariate polynomial, then the coefficients are just the elementary symmetric polynomials in zeros. The zeros of this polynomial in this case are the eigenvalues of x. So we denote by lambda of x the vector of eigenvalues of x, and then these polynomials we are interested in, pk, they are just the elementary symmetric polynomials in the eigenvalues of x. And this will be the description we want to look at. So are there any questions so far? So in any case, if you have questions, please just shout in or write in the chat. Okay, so this operation, like here having a symmetric polynomial and plugging in the eigenvalues of a matrix, this gives us another operation that preserves hyperbolicity. So to be more precise, so we take a symmetric polynomial H, so symmetric with respect to permuting the variables x1 to xn, and assume that it's hyperbolic with respect to the all ones vector. Then we can define the following function on D by D matrix, symmetric D by D matrices, which takes such a matrix, takes its vector of eigenvalues and plugs it into H. So this is well defined. So I mean, the only problem that could arise is that it's not well defined which order you want to take the eigenvalues, but since it's a symmetric polynomial, this doesn't matter. Then it's not hard to show that this polynomial H, or this function H, it is a polynomial in the entries of the matrix X, and it's hyperbolic with respect to the identity matrix, this polynomial, and the hyperbolicity cone of this new polynomial capital H is just the set of all matrices X whose vector of eigenvalues is in the hyperbolicity cone of our original polynomial that we started with. So this is older result due to Bausch, Bühler, Lewis, and Zendorf, and we can apply it now to our situation. So recall that we are interested in the hyperbolicity cones of these derivatives, and by our previous observation, this hyperbolicity cone consists of exactly those matrices whose vector of eigenvalues, whose spectrum is in the hyperbolicity cone of the corresponding elementary symmetric polynomial. So using this observation and a determinantal representation due to Raman Sanyal of this elementary symmetric polynomial of degree d minus 1 in d variables, James Saunderson could prove that the first derivative of this determinantal polynomial is spectrahedral. Now, Peter Brendin constructed a spectrahedral representation of the hyperbolicity cone of all elementary symmetric polynomials. So there is, I think, hope can generalize this method of James Saunderson to describe the hyperbolicity cones of arbitrary derivatives of that X. So the best possible result would be, of course, the following. So if we let's say we have any spectrahedral cone which is symmetric under permuting the coordinates, then we can look at all symmetric matrices whose eigenvalues satisfy the linear matrix inequality, and we want that, might ask if this set is always spectrahedral. So of course, by this result from one slide ago or two slides ago, this set is at least a hyperbolicity cone because S is a hyperbolicity cone. So the generalized Lux conjecture would imply that this is a spectrahedral cone. But I think in this, even if we would knew that this is true for some abstract reason, I think it would still be interesting to have a concrete construction which takes such a symmetric S and builds a spectrahedral representation for this spectral set here. And so the answer to this question is also yes, if S is a symmetric polyhedral cone. This also, this was proved by Raman Sanyal and James Saunderson in the recent preprint. And the goal of this talk is to, I mean, unfortunately not to, to show that this is true in general, but to give a sufficient criterion on S such which guarantees that this is a spectrahedral cone. And this criterion is a representation theoretic criterion. So let me, so let's recall that if you look at representations of the symmetric group Sn, then it's known that each representation is a direct sum of irreducible representations, and the irreducible representations of Sn have been classified. They are in bijection to partitions of N. And I call a representation of Sn short if it corresponds to a partition of length at most 2. So for N equals 4, these three are short representations. So this is like the, this Young diagram corresponds to the partition 4 of 4. This is 3 plus 1. This is 2 plus 2. So these are all short representations because they have at most 2 summons in the corresponding partition of N. These two are not short, so this is 2 plus 1 plus 1, and this is 1 plus 1 plus 1 plus 1. Okay, so questions so far? Okay. So, yeah, so I call the representation short if it consists only of irreducible representations corresponding to partitions of length at most 2. So the I think the basic example of the short representation, or the most important example for this talk, is the space of homogeneous multi-affine polynomials. So a polynomial is multi-affine if each monomial that appears in this polynomial is square free. So each variable appears with degree at most 1. And this vector space is a Sn representation, so Sn acts on the space by permuting the variables. It's clear that if you permute the variables of a multi-affine polynomial, it stays multi-affine. Then using elementary representation theory, one can show that this is in fact, so the space of degree d multi-affine polynomial or homogeneous degree multi-affine polynomials is in fact the induced representation of some smaller group, of the trivial representation of some smaller group, and then one can apply Young's rule to get a decomposition into irreducible components. I will be more precise on this, more explicit on this decomposition later. So now we know what a short representation is. So the main result is that if we have such a short representation of Sn and a linear map from R to the N to the set of symmetric bilinear forms over this vector space V, which is compatible with the respective actions of Sn, then we can take the pre-image of the set of positive semi-definite bilinear forms here. This will be a symmetric spectrahedral cone in R to the N. And under these conditions, the corresponding spectral set, so the set of all symmetric matrices whose eigenvalue is in S, is a spectrahedral cone. So from this result, we can also then deduce our result that we were originally interested in. So we can take Petter's representation of the hyperbolistic cones of elementary symmetric polynomials and show that they in fact come from such a short representation. And then apply the theorem and we get a spectrohedral description of these hyperbolicity cones. One can do some analysis on the size. So this the size of this of the matrices describing this hyperbolicity cone will be like of this magnitude. So for if we fix the number of derivatives k, then the size of the hyperbolicity of the matrices for describing this hyperbolicity cone will grow only polynomially. If you increase k and n simultaneously, then be exponential. So in the last few minutes, let me give some idea on the proof of this main theorem. So the more precise statement is the following. So we take a short representation and such a Sn linear map. And then we can, to V, we can associate, so V is a representation of Sn, we can associate to it a representation of the orthogonal group and a map which is On linear. So it's compatible with the action of the orthogonal group from the space of symmetric matrices to the symmetric bilinear forms on W, which is compatible with our original map. So a matrix here is sent to something positive semi-definite here if and only if the vector of its eigenvalues is sent by our original map to something positive semi-definite. So how can we do this? So we have already seen that this space of multi-affine polynomials of homogeneous of degree d decomposes into d plus one irreducible representations. I can also tell you which subspaces of this space are these irreducible subrepresentations. So this, the one corresponding to the partition n minus ii, is consists of all polynomials which are in the kernel of the d minus I plus one fold application of the derivative in direction e. So if you take d minus I plus one times derivative of polynomial here, you get zero. And moreover, it is in the orthogonal complement of all those polynomials where already the d minus I derivative vanishes. But this one can so since the E, the all ones vector is invariant under the symmetric group, it's not hard to show that these are in fact sub-representations. And then by the knowledge that it decomposes in D plus one components, we can prove this. So now we want to get from this some representation of the orthogonal group. And for this, we replace the multi-affine polynomials of degree d by the vector space spanned by the d times d minus of the generic symmetric n by n matrix. So why might this be a good idea? So if you restrict the elements here to the space of diagonal matrices, then you exactly get back this vector space. And then using some representation theory, you can decompose this again into irreducibles. It's not important what this EII stands for. It's just important to note that this space of minus of the symmetric matrix also decomposes into d plus one different irreducible components. And these irreducible components can be described in the very same way as the ones in the multi-affine case. It's the kernel of the d minus I plus one fold derivative now in direction of the identity matrix intersected with the orthogonal complement of this. So these ON representations are kind of very similar to these SN representations. And this is what we do. So if we have short representation V, we decompose it into irreducibles and replace each of these irreducibles by the corresponding irreducible representation of ON that we get in this manner. And yeah, then we also want to replace our map phi by some ON linear map. For this, we have to understand what kind of maps can we have from R to the N to space of symmetric bilinear forms on a short representation. So for this, we observe that if V decomposes into irreducibles, then the space of symmetric bilinear forms decomposes into blocks. And then we have to see what kind of SN linear maps we can have to all of these blocks. So we have to understand SN linear maps from Rn to symmetric bilinear forms on an irreducible short representation and to the homomorphisms from one irreducible to another irreducible representation. And yeah, I'm running out of time, so let's look at these ones. So one can show that basically these SN linear maps from Rn to these function or this homomorphism space is basically given by the derivative. So a point in R to the N is sent to the derivative, the directional derivative in direction A. And we have seen that we can view these vector spaces as subspaces of the multi-affine polynomials, and then it makes sense to apply this derivative operation. And then we want to replace it by something which is compatible with the orthogonal group. And for this, we just take again the derivative, but now in direction of a matrix rather than just a vector. And something similar works for the symmetric power. And then we can construct first from any V such a representation W of ON, and then from any map which is SN linear, we get such a map which is ON linear, and then we can show that this actually satisfies these conditions. And this proves the main result, which what we have already seen has as a consequence this problem whether or not these derivatives of determinantal polynomials have a spectral representation. Okay, yeah, time is up. Thanks for the attention, and are there any questions?
Oh, yeah. Thanks a lot, Mario. Really nice talk. One question is, so in your talk, or in, you considered iterating a derivative with respect to the hyperbolicity direction, but do you have a sense of whether you could take mixed derivatives with respect to different directions in the hyperbolicity cone?
This is a good question. I don't know. I mean, I think that this this method using this orthogonal group symmetries, I think this will not work if you go into different directions. because I mean only the identity matrix is so this is I don't know, this would be a good next question. Also not taking just derivatives of determinantal polynomials but of hyperbolic polynomials whose hyperbolicity cones are spectrahedral. It would be nice to remove that. Yeah.
So, yeah, I had sort of the same question as Nikhil, but maybe a twist on it. So your result when you have just one power of a directional derivative, then it corresponds to these elementary symmetric polynomials. But if you do it for, say, if you do it for two, say just, so you have a power of one directional derivative and a power of another one, would it correspond to some primitive then, not elementary symmetric polynomials, but some other, some other primitive hyperbolic polynomials that you need to show have the spectrahedral representations in your, but maybe more special spectrahedral representations that fit your sort of scheme.
What would maybe be, you could, for example, maybe take some symmetric polynomial, which is not the power of x1 plus xn, and then plug in the derivative operations, like the partial derivatives into this polynomial. You know what I mean? Taking, for example, the elementary symmetric polynomial and replace xi by partial I.
Yeah.
So maybe this would be a good, I don't know if this method would work, but this, then you would keep this, this symmetry. So maybe this would work. But I don't know if it preserves hyperbolicity. So I guess you would be the one to tell me if it preserves hyperbolicity if you do this.
I couldn't tell you from the top of my head right now because but presumably. Thanks for a great talk, by the way.
Thanks.
And this this bound on the dimension, so I guess in the case of elementary symmetric polynomials, if you allow projections, you can reduce that bound a lot. I don't know, do you have a sense of whether you can do that here?
You mean if you allow for projections?
If you allow projections of spectrahedra, then, I guess I was just remembering the situation for elementary symmetric polynomials.
For these derivatives, I think this is some work by Parillo and Saunderson, I think it also is very small, like polynomial in N or something.
So by allowing projections, they can do it.
By the way, if you allow for projections, then there's a general statement is true, which was shown by Sanyal and Saunderson, that if you have a symmetric spectrahedral shadow, then the corresponding spectral set, like all matrices with eigenvalues is in this original set, this is then again a spectrahedral shadow.
Oh, okay.
So for projections, this is very well behaved.
That's by Sanyal and that's by who?
James Saunderson.
Saunderson and Sanyal.
Yes.
Any other question?
Mario, so and with regards to this last result that you said, do you know if the size of the spectrahedral like shadow is comparable? Like, is it polynomial in the size of one or the other, or they just prove that it is a spectrahedral shadow without giving bounds on the size?
I don't know. Yeah, I would have to look at the paper. I suspect that they have good bounds in this case.
Okay, thanks.